small town not too far from Gadsden. So often we would make trips to Gadsden, and these trips would include stopping by Kmart in East Gadsden, where if I was good, I would get to ride the little carousel out front or the Bronco. Y'all probably remember those. You put a quarter in and you can ride them. And then after we were finished, we would go over to Western Sizzlin', not far away, and eat. Now, for those of you who have been around Gadsden, you remember those landmarks. And you also likely remember that right across the highway from the Kmart in East Gadsden was a fortune teller's house. And as a child, I was absolutely fascinated by the fortune teller's house. Here in Gadsden, Alabama, there was a person who could know my future. But as I started to grow older, I began to have more questions about this fortune teller. After all, how successful can you be as a fortune teller if you are setting up shop across from the Kmart in East Gadsden? And then I began to wonder, if you're a fortune teller, do you have regular hours, or do you automatically know when someone's going to pop in? And if you're a fortune teller, why are you wasting that gift on people in small town Alabama? Why aren't you doing yourself some good by investing in the stock market? Or why aren't you solving major world problems like hunger and war and violence? Why are you just telling people's future there on George Wallace Drive near Kmart? Well, of course, as an adult, I realize that fortune tellers have no real power. They don't know the future any more than I do. In fact, I would say I probably am more likely to know the future because I know that my future is in God's hands. Only God knows the future. Jesus knew the future. As he was coming toward the cross, he knew that the cross was looming large before him, and he knew what the will of the Father was. And he went to the cross for sinners like you and me. His entire life was pointing toward the cross, and he lived his life as someone who was going to die, and died so that we might live. Today we continue the journey of Ashes to Fire from Ash Wednesday to Pentecost by continuing to walk with Jesus on that journey through the prescribed gospel readings for each week. Now remember, there are prayer stations and studies that accompany this sermon series, and if you'd like to know more about them, please see me after worship. Today we look at Jesus' prediction of his own death. I invite you to take your Bibles and turn to the 12th chapter of the Gospel of John, verses 20 through 23. John 12, 20 through 23. I invite you to stand for the reading of God's Word if you are able. Now, among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks, and they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. One model trait of Jesus that we tend to overlook when we read the Gospels is Jesus' ability to manage his time and keep a calendar. Jesus had incredible demands upon his time, but those demands never stopped him from spending time with God, from going away from the chaos and spending time with the Lord in prayer. He made worship a priority. He observed all the holy feasts and made the trip from Galilee to Jerusalem several times a year. He never ignored the outcast, the unclean, and the downtrodden. He healed people in need. He taught. He mentored others. He used his time, that limited time, 3.5 years, to bring God glory, working his way toward the cross. He ordered his life and prioritized time for the glory of God. Jesus, sinless Son of God, is a model for our lives in that way. In the gospel reading for today, we see Jesus aligning his time properly once again. There are some Greeks who want to see Jesus. Now, we don't know what they know about Jesus. We don't even know if they are full converts to Judaism. They may be Greeks in the sense that that they have multiple gods that they worship. They might have not been fully monotheistic, but nonetheless, they were there in Jerusalem for the Passover. Jesus had made his triumphal entry, and they were interested to learn more about this Jesus they had heard a great deal about. So they request an audience with Jesus. They go and ask a disciple, "Can we see Jesus?" And so the disciples go ask Jesus. Andrew and Philip go ask Jesus, tell Jesus there are some Greeks that want to see you. Can you make time for them? Rather than answering them in an outright way, Jesus says, "Now's not my time. It is my time to be glorified." And he goes on in the scripture reading, which I encourage you to look at, and he says that his death is coming, that those who love their life in this world will lose their life, and those who hate their life will gain their life in eternity. Jesus' life is pointing to the cross, and he lets his disciples hear this as they are making requests of his time. Jesus tells them that his time is quickly approaching. He is heading to the place to give his life for many, so that God might be glorified and so that God might draw all people toward him. Not just the Jews at this place, but people like the Greek and people like the outsiders, the Gentiles, would come to the Lord. Now, likely this was not the answer that Andrew and Philip expected, but nonetheless, this is the answer that they received. They heard Jesus openly speak of his death. Jesus had a very limited time on the earth. Scholars believe about 3.5 years in earthly ministry. He's making it very clear to Philip and Andrew that his time is limited, and at this point it's very limited. It's in the midst of Holy Week, and the cross is just a few days away. He's letting them know that what he has to do is not doing with going to have an audience with the Greeks. The crowd may have wanted to meet this one that they'd heard so much about, but he didn't have time for that now. His mission at this point was not to impress others, but it was to prepare himself for the cross so that he might give his life for the Father and so that God may be glorified and make a way for all people. So how would you go about your regular routine if you knew that your time was limited? How would you spend your last week on earth if you knew it was your last week on earth? I would hope that I would spend my time with God and with family and enjoying both God and family to its fullest. Sorry, guys, I don't think I would make any more time for church meetings. I would spend my time with my priorities, what is important in my life. And sometimes I wonder, why am I not doing that now? Why do I not make God the priority in all situations? The truth is, we are all terminal, every single one of us. And we all have a limited time on earth. And in that limited time, every day, every minute, every second is a gift. And with that, we're invited to make God's glory and God's mission a priority. Knowing that the end of earthly life would be coming soon, it would likely influence the way that we spent every day. Each day is that gift that we need to keep in front of us. And for Jesus, that was ever present. The cross was looming large, and he was making priorities of the limited time that he had. So here we have Jesus with the knowledge of the cross, keeping it all in perspective about what was to come. He answered them, if you keep reading, and it says in verse 36, that he departed and he hid from them. He went away from the crowd and the demands upon his time. Then the scripture continues by saying that although he had performed many signs in the presence of the crowd, they still did not believe. Here was Jesus, not giving in to the demands of the crowd, not giving in to the demands of the world, but remembering the mission and looking ahead for what was to come. I like to think of this as an example of Jesus ordering God's priority upon his life. He was preparing for what God had him to do. He was focusing on what God wanted him to do. He was focusing on the will of the Lord. We would all do well to follow this example from Jesus to manage our priorities as such, keeping the Father first. Jesus said in verses 27 and 28, "No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." He is not going to take the requests that call him from his mission. He's going to stay faithful to that mission, knowing the hardship of the cross, all so that he may glorify the name of the Father. Jesus clearly said no to what was distracting him. The demands upon your time are nothing like what Jesus faced. As Philip and Andrew demanded an audience for the Greeks with Jesus, Jesus brought the conversation back to the mission and back to the task at hand to glorify God. While it may have been good to meet with these people and to teach them, he knew that this would be nothing but a distraction. And ultimately, through his work on the cross, God would draw all people to him. His response to the disciples, which was really no response, was ultimately saying no to the distractions of the world. A few weeks ago at the 8:30 service, Kevin preached about dealing with temptation. And he reminded the congregation in that sermon that when we deal with temptation, a good way to deal with temptation is to remember that we are a child of God. When we have that identity, we are able to deal better with the issues that we face. Anytime we face anything, we remind ourselves, I am a child of God. And we can face things that come up in our life and draw us from God. And I think that's a good way, a good reminder for us of how we manage our time. Just that simple reminder of our identity. I am a child of God. Each day is a gift, and I am a child of God. The Father has given me this gift, so how might I use this gift to honor my Father? I am a child of God. How will I spend my time? How will I prioritize my day? How will I live out the mission for which God has called me? Focusing on God and his mission for our lives helps us order our day, especially when we remember whose we are and how we are to be in the world. Jesus not only said no to the distractions, but he said yes to what was important. It is one thing to wrestle with the uncertainty of tomorrow, but it is another thing to know what tomorrow brings and face it head on, especially when that tomorrow brings death and betrayal and denial and torture and hurt. Jesus knew, and he went anyway. We continue by reading, "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." Even in troubling times, Jesus kept working for the glorification of God. Perhaps our journey with Jesus is about aligning our lives with Jesus being the priority, learning to say no to the distractions of the world and learning to say yes to what brings God the glory. When we keep in mind the mission and God's call upon our lives, we are better able to prioritize all the time that we have on earth and live it in a way that honors God. Now, I hate to break the news to you, but some of this, you know it's coming. It's not really news, but tax day comes on April 17th. You're lucky because you got two extra days this year. Some of you have already filed your taxes, got it back, and spent your return. Others of you have not even started. You are procrastinating, especially those of you who owe money and hate to see April 17th come. And many of you are like myself, and you're somewhere in between those two. Well, knowing many people who work in accounting in the tax preparation business, they say most people are the ones in denial, the ones who procrastinate, the ones who wait to the last minute. Some people don't even make it to the April 17th deadline. They have to file an extension and another extension. And don't feel bad if you're in that category, because a lot of people are. And it's our human nature. Our human nature is to procrastinate and to live in denial to what is coming, especially when that is coming is something we don't want to face, something we don't like, something that's painful for us. We want to put it off. But like it or not, no matter how much denial you do and procrastination happens, tax day will come. And if it doesn't come for you, the IRS will come for you. It's a matter of life. We see in our scripture reading for today, hard times were coming for Jesus. He didn't deny it. He struggled with it. He said he was anxious, but he faced it head on. He was dealing with the impending reality ahead. He was not only preparing himself, but he was preparing his followers for what was about to happen. In fact, he was leading them to that moment of the cross. His whole life was leading to that moment of the cross. Even as a baby, when the wise men came, they didn't bring him typical baby gifts. He received the gift of anointing oil for the dead. It was all leading him to the cross. Jesus went ahead and he went forward in ministry knowing what was before him. I said earlier that we are all terminal. Every single one of us, we are terminal. We may not know future specifics, but we know the future. We're not that psychic on George Wallace Drive, but honestly, we know how our lives on earth will end. It will end with, if we are followers of Jesus Christ, that transition into eternity, into heaven with Jesus and being in his love forever. Or it will end when Jesus comes back to fully reign. We know that in either case, God will be victorious, and we can rest in those promises. But until either one of those scenarios come, how are we going to live our life? Knowing the future, what are we going to do? My prayer is that we prioritize our lives, our schedule, and the gift of each day to make each day count and to give God the glory. Jesus knew what was ahead, and he is an example for us. He kept the mission before him, and we know salvation through him. He didn't back away from God's will or the future, but he went to the cross for sinners like us. Amen. Let us pray.